Sorry about that, my memory card filled up. So anyway, you need to know that they're equal when you tighten them down. So anyway, that's coming up. So now you can see it's in the fully up position, and that's how you want to install it. The other thing is the O-ring off of here. The O-ring off of here needs to come off and go on there. I don't want to damage it. I'm going to use this pair of forceps, but it's very pointy. I want to be careful not to cut it. Also, going around these threads is a bit of a challenge. You don't want to cut it, right? Overstretch it, ruin it. It's not that this is holding back so much fluid under pressure necessarily, but it definitely helps. Now you can see it's deformed a little bit. It should be fine as long as it's not torn, right? There's a little oil on there. I'm just gonna leave it on there for ease of installing. And then I'm just rolling it over the top. There we go. These threads are fine. They can be a little sharp at times, so you just need to be careful. You also need to be careful when you're screwing it in not to cross thread it. And but there's enough meat there and the O-ring that you don't need a ton of pressure to torque that down. All right, so that's that one. I'll do the other one when we get to it. And then I'm going to remove the spring for now. Okay, so what's our next challenge? According to the instructions, these were printed out for me very graciously, as I mentioned, by the dealership. I'll put a link below for an online link I found to download for the manual. It's a bit of a cumbersome manual. You can search, but you can't click on sections. There's a lot of scrolling, and the way it's set up is a little difficult from Royal Enfield to find certain things. But anyway, it shows here that I need 430 milliliters per fork, right? So I have a couple of options. I have my handy dandy ratio right cup, but this does not show milliliters. It shows gallons. It shows ratios. On this side, we've got pints, cc's, and fluid ounces. So let's do a quick conversion using the Google and seeing how many fluid ounces milliliters are. Where's my phone? Let's try this. The Google. Come on. So we'll type in ml to fluid ounces. Can you see that? Milliliters is 14.54 fluid ounces. You see that? So let's call that 14.54. All right, so my fluid ounces here, that goes up to 10. No, I'm sorry, 18. What did I say? See, my brain's not. 14.54, 14 and a half. So there's 14. Can you see that? That's 16. I actually have a little line scored here from a previous fill, not on this bike, but it looks to be the same. Halfway between these two should be 15. Halfway between that should be 14 and a half, right? So I think 14.5 should do it right about there. I'm happy with that. The other option we had was this handy, this is a fork oil level gauge. You've got a syringe with milliliters. Now this only goes up to 60, so I'd have to fill it several times. This handy tube, and then this metal tube that has numbers on it. I believe those are increments in millimeters. And then you have this collar. Basically what you do is like I said, I could fill this up, so 60 goes into 430 divided by 2 square root of pi, something like 7 million times. So if you were to fill this enough times and then pour it into the fork tube to get 430 milliliters, great. The other way this thing works is a lot of fork oil measurements give you an air gap. That means how much height there should be from the top to where the fluid begins when this is fully down. And what you would do is you would take this tube, you can't really see the numbers on it, but you would feed it through this hole. That's a hole down, right? And you push it through like this until the millimeters or centimeters you need air gap is showing. Then you would tighten this down, but usually it'd be more than that. And then this would sit on top of here inside. And so you would overfill your tube just a little, stick this into the appropriate length, and then pull on this plunger to suck up whatever extra fluid is in there, and then when it reaches the appropriate height, there's no more fluid to suck up. Does that make sense? It's a pretty neat tool. They're cheap. I think this was like 20 bucks. Maybe it was 17 bucks. I got this from Too Fast Moto on eBay. I bought quite a few things from them. That's their part number. I'll put a link to them and this part underneath, but you can buy this from a variety of sources. But we're not going to have to use that, so that's good. All right, so let me back you up because I'm going to be working on the ground after the table. So, we'll sit that right there. Don't want it to fall. Then we'll take our handy dandy schmeeksmot. Need a flat surface. So I'm using Torco. I've never used Torco before, but I've been told it's a good brand from two different bike shops. Mentions on the back here some of the brands you can use it with. I think I mentioned that earlier. And Olin, Showa, Marzocchi, those are all like schnazzy. So should be fine. This is a liter. We need 430 per leg, that's 860, and a liter is 1,000, right? So we have enough. Next step is carefully pour it into the cup until I reach my desired level. So I can see my mark here. I'm sure they give you a little leeway, but you don't want to go over. Sorry, stopped filming, didn't realize it. I suck at this still. So what I was saying is they probably give you a little bit of leeway when you fill these up, but you don't want to go over. I'm as close as I can get with that. I'm happy with that. All right. The other thing I had mentioned earlier in this video, which is like 17 hours ago, or that's what it feels like to me, that I'm using 15 weight oil because I want to stiffen up the front. So that is 15 weight. Now, keeping that in mind, not every fork oil is made the same. Excuse me, there's not a standard. So this 15 weight may be different than a Motorex 15 weight or a Motul 15 weight. So if you have a brand you like and you get to know it, you can stick with it, right? All right, so that's filled to the line. I'm just making sure my flat washer is still in there. It is, but it moved. I just want to make sure it's flat and in the right orientation. There it is. Right orientation, I mean, I'd like the flat part to be down. So now I'm going to carefully pour this into here. And hopefully it doesn't all come pouring out the bottom. Again, I made sure that everything was clean. There's no debris, no detritus. Pour that in. And because of stiction, like it's still dripping, I want every drop to get in there good to the last drop. Make sure your this cup is clean, doesn't have any old oil in it or any dirt or dust. Still dripping. Almost there. It's quite a bit though. That's why I didn't want to use the syringe to fill and refill it so many times to get the correct amount. There'd be some loss, at least in my mind. All right, I'm good with that. Now we're going to pump them up a few times, slowly. You can hear it moving in there. Want to make sure everything is good. Trying to get any air bubbles, voids out of there. 10, 12 times, 20. 7 days later. All right. I'm okay with that. Am I? All right. Now, taking my spring, tighter coils down, carefully inserting that. Okay, next. We have our spacer. So that's going to sit up there until I pull the fork leg up. You know what I'm going to do beforehand? I almost forgot. Let's lean this on the side. And Dun, 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 dun. Royal Enfield fork gaiter. There's a little Royal Enfield symbol there. I want to face that front. So I'll put it on for now. And then I'll situate it afterwards. What we've got here, this came with it. You've got two of these band clamps. These go on the top of the fork gaiter. It comes with a little Allen head bolt and nut, no lock washer. Interestingly enough, I'm going to see if I have some. And then they give you this red Loctite bolt. That's actually a spare bolt for your ABS sensor. For some reason, in the instructions, because instructions do come with the fork gaiters too, which also include torque specs and things for like your calipers, everything you have to undo to pull the fork leg out. They want you to replace that for your ABS sensor for some reason. So I'll do that. In the meantime, what they want you to do is, and in case you're wondering, there's a little hole here that's for air, allows it to compress without blowing up. They want you to slide this over the top of this. These things have a weird consistency. They're not quite as stiff as you'd think. I mean the gaiter. They're definitely flexy. Right? So, we're not going to put the bolt in that yet. We are, however, going to slide this down. Now, this has to pull down over here, and you can see there's a little cutout there. You'd think this has a little lip inside of it that will pop into that. So let's do that now. I'll compress them all the way for now. I'll try and get it as straight as I think I can with that little R facing forward. But I can adjust it after. Right? So that's in. That's easy enough. These should be pulled up after. Okay, so next step. Excuse me. Pull the tube up all the way. Without that popping out. Now, my spring is in there. Next is my spacer. There's no orientation. Make sure it's clean. Let's clean that puppy. My tube may fall, may not. Swiping it off inside to make sure it's clean. It has been sitting in a dusty garage for a couple days, right? You do not want to introduce any of that. All right. Spacer goes in. And then we've got our flat washer. There's no orientation, but I can see the witness marks where it was touching the spring. And then making sure there's a little bit of oil on this O-ring, which there is, I'm going to, by hand, as best I can, get that started without cross-threading it. That's all it really needs. Is this a 27? No, it's bigger. I can do this by hand. The fact that I can turn it is a good indicator that it's not cross-threaded. The O-ring is getting ready to seat. If I had some gloves on, it would be even easier because this stuff is a little slick. So it's almost all the way in. The O-ring has gone most of the way in. That's about as far as I can. Well, it's going a little more. It's just getting tight. I will put a socket on it after, but I just want it in there as best as I can. It looks kind of sharp, doesn't it? Especially because my bike is black and chrome and silver. So, looking at the pitting right there, I wonder if that contributed to the leak. But for all intents and purposes, this fork leg is done. That's what it takes. Okay? Again, this needs to be snugged down. And then we'll insert it into the bike. But the the fork seal has been replaced. And the new fluid installed. And that's the procedure for that. So I don't need to film the second one. Definitely ask me any questions you may have. But that's that one. And that's kind of all I have time for right now anyway. But the other fork is exactly the same process. Okay? What I may do now is, before putting it on the bike, I want to pull that reflector off and clean these up. Because I think it'll be easier. Alright? So let me pause you. And that's it for the moment. I literally only have like 5 minutes, so I'm just gonna pull that off. I noticed that if I just, oh, by the way, I tightened this. I had to use my big crescent wrench, my adjustable wrench, because it's my largest socket is 27 millimeters. That's a little bigger. And then I just took a paper towel, put it around the nut portion of the fork cap and just snugged it down. So now it's snug. Once it's in the bike and the triple tree's holding this stuff in place, I'll give it one last, you know what I mean? So, but looking at this thing, I can kind of peel it up by hand. It's held on by double-sided tape. I don't want to break it, of course. I could apply some heat, but I think if I just take this plastic thingy and start prying up on it, I'll get it off without any heat. I just don't want to snap it. I want to save all these parts for posterity's sake. I'd rather get it off with the tape, and the plastic's not going to mar the paint. At least you hope it's not, right? There we go. Opa. Oh, can you see? You can see. All right, so that came off the glue, the double-sided tape, but that's basically all there is to it. All right, a little heat, a little goof off, something. I'll peel this off as best I can for now. I'm gonna worry about the final cleanup afterwards, because I just don't have the time. You know, I will say something. I'm a little concerned. I hate when I used the impact driver to tighten that bolt under there. It's a bit much, but the concern was that the damper tube would spin, so you kind of need that quick hammering kind of spinning action. But now that I have the socket and my homemade shmeep shmop, it should be much easier to tighten the other one down. All right, let me peel this off and then I'll call it a day for now. I'm gonna stand this thing up, make sure it's not leaking overnight, and then we'll do the next one. All right, folks, thanks for sticking in there. We'll move on shortly. Hey, really quick, I'm just cleaning up the residual sticky back stuff that had the reflector on it. I tried a little bit of brake cleaner, carb cleaner, because I love that stuff, but it actually takes the paint off. Be careful. I had that happen once before with these forks. So now I'm using this just Goo Gone automotive goo and sticker remover. It's like a citrus based cleaner. I'm just spraying some excuse me, on a paper towel and then soaking it and rubbing it. I'm using some elbow grease, but it's coming off. I'm also utilizing my fingernails after it gets soaked a little bit. It's taking a little time, but it's coming off and it's not harming the paint or anything. All right, so just want to give you that little bit of info. I've got just a little bit of time before work today, so I wanted to just do a little bit on the bike. Okay, write that down. One more thing I'm trying. I have this Ultimate Compound by Meguiar's. Where that sticky stuff was, it's a little dull, and also there's just this really weird orange peel looking finish on the fork leg. See if you can see that. And I thought maybe I got something on it, like a spray or something, or I thought maybe it was from just debris from riding, you know, wind, dirt, sand. But the other fork leg is not like this, so I don't know, maybe I got something on here by mistake, or maybe the finish was just always like that and I never noticed. So I'm taking this Meguiar's, let me zoom you back out. This is a very, it's a polishing compound, so it's a slightly abrasive, right? And you basically rub it onto the paint and it'll clean up any scratches, imperfections, etc. I'm gonna do it by hand with a paper towel. My battery's about to die, so let's just do this, see what happens. Can you see? Is my head in the way? See it, dirt, a little bit of paint, that's just how it works. Wipe it clean. Well, it's much shinier. I'll call that a win. I'm gonna redo it down here. I'm also gonna, there's some residual stickiness on there. My battery's about to die, so I'm just gonna continue with that. Just wanted to show you. All right, got the right leg back on the bike. I'm sorry, left leg. I haven't set the heights or anything yet or reattached the headlight. I just kind of wanted to slide it into place. Hopefully you can see this is super shiny now after using that polishing compound. It still has a little bit of that orange peel, but not too bad. Anyway, just wanted to make a little progress. And there's my Gaiter. Rawr. See you later. Hey, I just wanted to show you guys really quickly. This is my fork tube damper holder version 2.0. This worked a lot better. Basically, I've got two 27 millimeter nuts on here. That's mainly so they don't spin, okay? Because 27 millimeter socket right here, that's the biggest I could get to fit inside the tube. Any bigger and it won't slide. So this actually will insert into the tube like this. This, the head of this bolt that fits these 27 millimeter nuts is slightly bigger than that. Slightly bigger than 27 millimeters. So I cannot get a socket that fits that and stick it in this way, but that's okay because the top of the damper rod is a little bit bigger than 27 millimeters. It's the size of the head of this bolt. Imagine that. So, if you use two nuts here, again, they do not have to be Nylocks with the taper. They could just be flat ones. I just have two on there so they don't spin. You slide this in the tube like that, and then with this 20-inch extension with a 27 millimeter, and a ratchet on there, slide that in until the head of this sits into the top of that 12-point damper rod. And then on the other end, you insert your Allen and your other ratchet, and you can snug it up. All right. Then I actually took my air gun and just kind of hit it a couple times just to make sure, but not as insanely as last time. Okay, this is the second leg, by the way. The first leg is on the bike. Shik shik. Temporarily in place, just kind of held. Gaiter. Hey, have I shown you the part number for these fork seals yet? Here you are. Part number 594406, oil seal diameter 41, made in India. Triumph Albuquerque, now known as Motopia, New Mexico. All right, there you go. All right, let's see about getting this done. I've got both forks filled with oil. I've got the preload adjusters on top. Now I have to adjust the height, and that was questionable, if you remember. That seems like 10 years ago. What I'm going to do right now is use my caliper, get the heights I wrote down. So this one was 9.69 from the top of the triple tree. Let's raise you up here so you can see all that. Get you right in on it. See what you can see. There you go. Alright. So I took my measurement from this leading edge of this front cutout. So let me get my, I just have the fork tubes in there just snug enough to keep them in place. I want to get the height, and then I want to turn this too, so one of the points of the preload adjusters is facing forward. So let me set up my caliper to the correct height, millimeters. I need a new caliper, folks. By the way, I have to go to work later, so I'm just doing as much as I can before going to work. Maybe that's why I sound a little bleh. So, not from the black, but from the silver, right? So that's got to come up. Just so you see, I have this set at 9 point... Oh, it's freaking out. It's 9.69, right? The more importantly is that they're both even. So I'm going to loosen the bottom triple trees that I had snugged up. I don't have the headlight in yet, or the handlebars snugged down. Just the triple trees. So let's go up. What's going on here, folks? That's loose. Oh, bottom one. Let's get this one again. Oh, I guess I tightened the handlebar. Sorry. That's what I get for working on this several days in a row. All right, let's get cracking. Right there. Have that forward. I'm happy with that right there. Let's snug it down and double check it. I'm happy with that. I'm happy with the orientation of that. Let's snug these down for the moment, and then I will torque them down. Just so nothing moves. Now I think if you use the interceptor, you cannot use these as is. You'll have to put risers on the interceptor bars because they'll hit. Keep that in mind. Let's do the other one. I'm going to do the same thing to the other one. You don't have to watch. But here's something to keep in mind. If you look at my caliper, so you have this gauge that peeks out of the bottom, right? That's the height. I'm using the top of this even with the top of the silver part of the tube. And then you see this cutout? See, it's got a cutout. I'm making sure that the part that's not cut out is closest to the tube when resting on the triple tree. Make sense? All right. All right, let me do the other one. I'll bring you back. All right, I've got both forks in. They're at the same height. At this point here, right there, they're both at exactly the same height according to my calipers, which for me was 9.69 millimeters. If you remember, this was 969 and this was 969 and this one was 869 when we originally measured. I'm going to work on the assumption that these are milled the same. They look pretty dang close. There's a good chance, if that was the issue, that I was a millimeter lower here, why the bike is pulling to the right when I take my hands off the bars, as well as why the fork seal blew. We'll see. So the first thing I'm going to do now is I'm going to actually snug these top and bottom triple trees to spec. My shop, Motopia, was very kind enough to give me a cheat sheet so I don't have to scroll through the unwieldy shop manual. I will leave this up here for a moment and you can press pause and write this stuff down or memorize it, even better. There will be a test. Everything's in Newton meters, so then I use the Google. So you can see 20 Newton meters is 14.75124 foot-pounds. I'm going to call that 15. So upper triple tree and lower triple tree clamps, 20 Newton meters equals 15 foot-pounds. If you want to be a stickler, you can set it to just under 15. I'm going to stick with 15. So first things first, I haven't used my this torque wrench in a while. The lowest setting is 10. I'm going to leave it on 10 and just tighten up until it clicks at 10 and click it a few times. That should get the grease inside and the mechanism all set up and lubed how it needs to be. get that in there very carefully. When you torque stuff down, you don't want to stop abruptly and then on your next turn it goes click. You want to go nice and easy. Then a couple of extra clicks to make sure. Let's get the other side. My Kawasaki's in the way. All right, so again, nice, easy, smooth. Got that click. Nice, easy, smooth. And you want to keep everything as perpendicular as possible, meaning this perpendicular to this. You don't want to be like that or that. All right, it's all about smooth. I've left the ears for the headlight and turn signals loose for the moment. So that A, I have room to get in here, and B, I can, I'll adjust them after. Okay, so we did 10, I'm going up to 15, I'll go a hair below 15. So what you do, in case you don't know, I don't know if you can see these hash marks, similar to hash browns, but slightly different. So right now, this mark says 0, and the line of 0 points to 10, so that's 10 pounds. The next line is 11, 12, 13, 14, so 15, so a hair below 15, before 15. You happy with that? I'm not. I'm going right up to 15. All right, let's do this. Can you see what I'm doing? I sure hope so. Let's back you out a little. There we go. Nice. See, nice smooth pull, and it clicks through that pull. It's not right at the end of the fit where I have to readjust. That's scary. Scaring me. Nice. That seemed to be more than I thought, and I've heard horror stories of the hardware on these things stripping. Sometimes you just gotta go for it. Other times you've gotta be careful. It's kinda hard to know which, even with years of experience. It just sorta, stuff does happen. There we go. So the triple trees are now torqued. The next step would be to torque the handlebar bolts, which, let me double check my cheat sheet here. Handlebar clamps, 20 newton meters, so they're the same. Let's do that. Now because my torque wrench is already warmed up at this point, I'm just gonna go for it. I don't have to go to 10, I can go right to 15. And of course, make sure that the handlebars are seating in the right position. There is a pin that locates them into the bottom of the top triple tree. I'm just looking here, I see a little bit of a gap there and not one as much on this side. I don't like that. So I'm going to loosen that. I'm going to loosen this and make sure it's set in the right spot. You do not want to use your torque wrench to loosen stuff and break free tight bolts. It's not what it's designed to do. And it could end up damaging or throwing off the calibration. You see, I'm going to hold. Even though the locating pin, can you see what I'm doing? Why don't you just say something? Sheesh. Let's zoom you in. So Sorry, my nose is stuffy too. So right up in here, right up in your grill, right up in your face. I don't know if you can see that because of this cable. Let's set you up. So, right in there, that gap, I don't like it. So if I lift up on this, see how it shuts, closes that gap. So the locating pin is where it needs to be. There is a bracket that runs from the top triple tree bolt, which I'm pointing at right now, to the bolt for the handlebar, but that doesn't mean that it's sitting as high up as it needs to. So I'm gonna hold it there while I tighten. So that's the kind of stuff you wanna keep an eye out for. Okay. Oops, I bumped you. And now let me zoom you back out. So that's snug now. I'll still hold it up a bit, but it did indeed move the handlebar so that it was closer to the bottom triple tree. All right, let's do the same thing for this side. Oh, male lady's here. Hi, Nancy. Sorry about that. I had to say hi to my mail lady. So just always make sure this hasn't moved, you know, after you do a set of tightening. I want to loosen that a bit. Make sure it's in the right place. I know my back is blocking you. Okay, there we go. See how that, like, I stopped here and it didn't click, and then as soon as I hit it, it clicked? I don't like that. So, I'm going to loosen it again. This is in my way slightly. A little bit. And then tighten it. That's very important. This way you're guaranteed that you got the right torque value. See how that clicked on a nice long pull like that? All right? So keep that in mind. Cool. Done. Now, the one thing I'd mentioned I wanted to do, I want to make sure these are as snug as they can be, because I did snug them while they were off the bike, but you can't put a whole lot of pressure on them like that. They don't need a ton of tension, right? There is a torque spec, but nice and hand tight is plenty. See, that one was a little loose. And that's another reason, like, not measuring it from the black part, but also those could be off. The tops of the tubes are always going to be likely even. All right, looks good, looks good. I'm happy. Let's move on. All right, all my fasteners are torque down, they're checked, and double and triple checked. Just got to make sure that everything is good, right? It's very important. Last thing you need is your fork leg to come flying up through the triple tree while you're riding. That would be bad. Now, next step, what I want to do is I'm going to put the bolts into the side of the ears that attach to the headlight, and then we'll set the height of the headlight. All right? Let me set you up for that. One quick note, once you're done using your torque wrenches, you want to loosen them up and set them back down to the lowest setting. which in this case is 10 pounds. So I just loosen that, roll that back until the zero is on the 10 line, and then snug it up, and that should keep it in good shape. All right, now, real quick, I've got my headlight bolts and my measure. Where are my headlight bolts? Oh, here they are. So I don't have these tightened up yet. I'm gonna use a 4mm Allen and do it by hand. I'm just gonna snug them up enough so they kind of stay in the general vicinity. Using my measurement I had before I took it apart, right around there. I'm not going for precision at the moment, just going for a general location. Just use that real quick. Just enough to try and keep it in place where it's not going to be sliding down on me constantly. And again, general vicinity. Right about there. Same thing with the other side. Go. It's close enough. So they're just about in the same spot. Right about there. And then we've got our, excuse me, these bolts right here. I am not going to Loctite them or anything. Just gonna hold this up, get one started. Now be careful if this ear is like way out here and you start trying to screw the bolt in, you will likely strip the threads. So get them as even as you can. Kind of wiggle things around a little. Ease it in. Don't force it. And then this side, make sure nothing's blocking in the back. You've got a bunch of cables and wires and brake lines and hoses and whatnot, right? Make sure everything's free. I'm free. See, it's a little snug. I do not want to force it. Also make sure these are as straight as you can because they can kick one direction or the other. It's snug. I don't want to force it. There we go. And now I will grab my wrench, 12mm. I will slowly Now I'm not going to snug it up all the way because if you remember, I messed up the aim of the headlight, the up down. So we're going to have to aim that later. But I just wanted to get it in. There we go. And now, more importantly, have that straight, and then have that straight. I may wait until I have the wheel on, and it helps sometimes, front wheels on, sit on the bike, and then look over the top and see how that's aimed, right? So I'll leave these loose-ish and these loose-ish, so after the wheel's on, we can adjust that, and so it's not pointing off to one side or the other, and then we'll worry about the aiming. That's about it for the moment, okay? Next step would be, I believe, put the wheel back on, grease the axle, get the speedo drive gear, caliper, ABS sensor, then we can line all this up, and then we can finally line up the gaiters so that they, the emblem is facing the direction I want. Right, kind of want them facing forward like that. Positioning is easy. And also with the weight of the bike on the front will determine how high up you want to put that too. So, okay, that's it for today. I've got more coming. I just have to prepare for work. Talk to you later. So, I have a little more time. So, I want to just mount the front wheel just because. I'm wiping off the axle. I just want to dry fit it in through because remember the height should be the same now on the fork legs, but because of the way the triple tree is cut, up. I think I can. Seems to line up well. It's a little snug. Binding a little, but that just might be because these are off a little bit, you know. Knock it back out. But I feel pretty good about it. Make sure you use a brass punch to do that. Yeah, it lines up. Goes right in. I don't think it's going to be an issue. I think where my heights are now are correct. All right, let's do it. So, I'm just going to put the wheel in. I'm not necessarily going to torque it down. Where is my wheel? There it is. So the speedo drive goes on this side. I will take a peek in here. I don't see any grease on the inside. I wonder if it's a sealed bearing. That bearing sealed. What you need to do is, can you see here? There are these two tabs on the drive gear itself, and on the inside of the fork leg is this boss. So that boss has to sit in between those tabs. That will allow the speedo drive to work without this spinning. Alright, so let's wheel that into place. You don't have to put the caliper back on yet, but you do need this spacer that goes on the caliper side. The thin side goes towards the wheel. That's how it came out. Let me wipe off some of the old grease. Just take a peek. Make sure there's no grease or anything on your caliper or on your ABS plate. That's clean. That's clean. I guess there's grease inside of there, I would think, perhaps, unless that's an electronic with a magnet. Anywhere. So this slides on and then pops into place. Let me check something here. Ah, another point. So if you look on here, you see these two cutouts? There's one right there and one right there. The speedo drive, besides having these two tabs that sit between the boss, there's a cutout there and there, and that's what'll spin when your wheel's spinning to give you your speed, right? So those have to sit in these notches right here. So that's also important. Let's do that. Just get them so it fits in. And then you slide this in place. Now I could drop the bike a little bit just to make this easier. So let's do that ever so slightly. I'm doing it by hand. I'm making sure too that this cable's not bound or kinked or any such weirdness. I'm just having this come down far enough to not have to lift the wheel off the ground when I run the axle through. Spacer keeps popping out, but that's okay. I should be able to get it in. Nice. And now, a word from our sponsors. Good, that's good. Gonna take a bit of rag and put grease on the shaft of my axle. This is a general multi-duty complex grease. It's got some higher heat tolerances, which I like. Make sure it goes on clean. There's no grit in there. Nothing bad. Alright. Okay, alright, alright, okay. Close that up so I don't sneeze in it. Let's start feeding my axle through. Always takes a little bit of finesse. So now that I have it in on this side, I realize the bike's gotta come back up a little smidge. A smidge.
like a puzzle. What I'm looking at is the hole on this side of the fork to allow the axle to slide through. And then you can actually get it up off the ground a little bit if you like. Once it's mostly through, it's off the ground now, making sure everything stays lined up. That is all the way through. The flats here are like that. I want them up and down. That's because that's how I like it. Making sure that the ears of the speedo drive gear are where they need to be. Making sure that the spacer on this side is where that needs to be. Now it's not wrong to have the flats like this. I just want to move it a little, because this kick out here, that gets in the way. So if I move it enough to where I can get a nice bite on it, right? Flat washer, flat side towards the bike. Nylock, screwing it on by hand. And I'm just going to snug it down to pull the fork legs in, because currently, here, let me show you. So here's what's going on this side. We got that spacer in. The narrower side faces that way. Flat washer, nut. You see the gap here? So when I tighten that nut down, it'll close that gap, right? And you see how the ears are on either side of that boss? Okay, let's do that. Alright, so I'm just going to start snugging this up, making sure everything stays where it's supposed to. Right? So now the gap here, there's a space between the fork and the speedo drive gear, but that's the shoulder of this. But the little gap that was in there is now closed down. My wheel spins, so that's good, right? Next is to torque that down. So I would like, you know what, I've changed my mind. I'm gonna leave it flat like that. Let me go get my big torque wrench. So according to that cheat sheet, it's 70 newton meters, which is 51.62 foot pounds. So I'll go to 51.5. But I'm gonna start off at 10, just to prime my torque wrench. It's already at 10. I'm gonna go up to 30. Okay. And now let me go up to, I'll go up to 52. It won't hurt it, that 0.4. So this is the same as the other one, just bigger, half inch drive, longer for more leverage. But same idea, you unscrew the bottom, screw the handle in. They have digital ones, and they also have ones that just have a rod where as you tighten it, it points to the correct poundage or newton meterage or what have you itch. And just like before, nice steady pull. And there we go. That's torqued. That's spinning. Doesn't feel weird. There's no binding. That's a plus. Okay, now I shall call it a day. Next step will be to install the guide bracket, the caliper and ABS sensor, the front fender, and then we'll move on from there. Okay, see you in a while. Just make sure to untorque your torque wrench. You don't want to store it torqued. Always go to the lowest setting. All right, who wants to get this done as much as I do? Next step, put the front fender back on. Got my bolts. Just got the flat washers on there. I'm not using any Loctite or anything. I'm putting the bolts back in the same holes they came out of, just cause that's how I am. Right? Nothing crazy here. Pretty straightforward. Nice. And number four. Alright, let's tighten that down. Oh, wrong. There we go. There is a little play in that fender, so make sure it's sitting square before you tighten it down. That's important. Looks good. Just gonna snug it down. I'm not using a particular torque value. Just nice and snug. You don't want to over tighten it either, of course. Just right. It's a beautiful day here for riding. All right, fender's on. Next, let's reattach the speedo cable bracket. It's just the bolt that goes right here. Nothing too crazy. Just make sure it's not, it hasn't twisted or bound or anything like that. And it's a 10 millimeter nut, I'm sorry, bolt. Again, just snug it up. Oh, and look, no reflectors. Looks good. With the goof off and got the glue, and then I took the paint polishing compound, shined them right up. I think they look great. I don't have these in place yet. I just have them pushed up to come out of the way. All right, let's move on to the brake caliper and ABS sensors. bring it to the other side. All right, so let's clip this zip tie. Let this hang. So first we've got the caliper. I'm just checking to make sure that no oil got in there by mistake, any fork oil when I dumped it. It should slide right back on, or close to it. I depressed the brake lever by mistake, just a schmeech. You shouldn't do that. All right, so that's in place. We've got our caliper bolts. I'm gonna use a dab of blue Loctite on it. A dab will do you. Line that up in the hole. Start it by hand. Get the bottom one in. There was some old blue Loctite on here. I made sure to clean it off as best I could. I use some dental tools to do that. Those are great. Great tools for the mechanic and restorer. For sure. Oh, can't quite get it to line up. There it is. Alright. So let me start tightening that down. 13 millimeter, making sure you can see. And then these will get torqued down. Try and do them evenly. Don't tighten one all the way and then the other one, because it could bind just a little bit. Okay, okay. So according to the manual, this is a 45 newton meters, which equals 33.19 foot-pounds. So I'll say 33. I'm gonna leave this on 10, haven't used it since yesterday, and just get it to click a couple times at 10. All right. Let's go up to 20. Now you may ask, like, why am I using the shorter one here and not the bigger one? This doesn't need a whole lot. 33 foot-pounds, that's a decent amount of torque, but it's not crazy. And you get a little more precision with the smaller torque values. All right, now I'm gonna go up to 33. Okay, torqued. Next, we have our ABS sensor. I did get a little oil on here. What I'd like to use is, I'm gonna use some of this electronic cleaner. You'd use this on like your electrical connectors, etc. Doesn't harm anything. It's a little more expensive, but it's worth it. Sometimes the more harsh cleaners can damage plastics and what have you. So prior to installing this, we have to remember there's this shim that has to go in place, like so. Okay, you see that? Like this. And then let's see if I can get you down here so you can see. That shim is imperative. Let's see what I can do here. So you've got the larger hole there that
this slides into, you got your mounting hole there, and prior to doing that, you have to take your shim, slide your shim like so, and then put it on. Okay, let's do that. So, one other point. This was the bolt that came out. Where are you? That came out. But then with the fork gaiter kit, there are nuts and bolts in here for the gaiters, but then you've got this new bolt with red Loctite already on it. How conveniently nice of them. See? So they recommend you reuse that bolt. So what I'm going to do is take this, put the shim in place, stick the bolt through to hold that where it needs to be, and then just kind of get it started. You want to make sure that that shim doesn't pop out. Oops, wrong size. There we go. Let's see. Is that in place? Yes. Is my shim in place? Yes. And then I'm screwing that down. I'm going to go look on the fork gaiter paperwork, see if there's a torque value. Okay, so according to the fork gaiter instructions, this is 10 newton meters, which is 7.37 foot-pounds. But this torque wrench of mine, the smallest it goes is to 10 foot-pounds. I'm quite comfortable tightening this by hand, just using my ratchet and knowing that it's going to be okay. Also, the four bolts for the front fender, those are rated at 10 newton meters or 7.37 pounds as well. That's fine. Snug is fine. And then you take your cable here and you carefully push it back into the clip so it doesn't hit anything. All right, so that should be that. Spin that tire. Let me I'll engage the brake a few times. I'll show you what I'm doing. Back out. So all I'm doing here is gonna spin this by hand and engage the front brake. There we go. And I'm also looking to make sure that the ABS sensor is not hitting, which it is not. Okay. So that's all good. Next step. Let's do the next step. Hang on. All right, here's the next step. I shut the garage door, by the way, because of the light coming in, you couldn't see. I put a piece of brick stones thing under my kickstand, making sure the kickstand is forward. We are now going to lower the bike down to the ground, okay? So carefully, slowly, carefully. You want it. Grasp the bike in such a way that in case you have a problem, you can control it. Just coming down slowly. I'm off the stand and just making sure it's on the stone. Simple enough. So, next, if you remember, there's a pinch bolt. The bottom of the axle on that side, that is not tight yet, it's just in place, but it's just finger screwed in. Now I'm going to pump the front forks up and down a bunch of times. Somebody recommended doing this. What it should do is allow the front axle to fully seat itself where it needs to be,
and then we can tighten that front bolt. And that's a 25 newton meter spec, which is 18.43 foot-pounds. So, let's get the brick out of there. I'm just gonna pump it a few times. All right. So according to that person, that should seat the axle if it wasn't already seated well. And now I'm going to take and tighten down that pinch bolt. It's at 18.43. Let's go to 18.5. That's 20, 18.5, let me make sure. Never hurts to double check. Oh no, I was higher. So 10, 18.5, there you go. Gotta undo it. Something weird going on with my torque wrench. So as I mentioned earlier, I'm not using the torque wrench to loosen this. I'm using my regular ratchet and then putting it back on the torque wrench to tighten it. Double checking my setting. Go torqued. All right, so that front end is back on, should be fine. Next, we're gonna set up the headlight. It's gonna be a little bit of a fun thing to do. What we're gonna do first is double check the height that the headlight ears are on. Right, so I had measured those prior to starting. I'm gonna put them back at the same measurement, just a smidge low. Now it's a smidge high. All right, let's bring that down to get it where it needs to be. Alright, so these are at the height I want them. Now I'm going to sit on the bike and see if it's pointed straight or like this or like this. I believe I'm happy with that. Sorry, I didn't trust my rock. I'm happy with that. Let me double check it from this angle. Yeah, I think it's good. Let me check the height one more time, and then we can snug it down. That is correct. That is correct. One last peek from the top. Yeah, I think that's all right.
Okay.
This is going to be the fun part, tightening down that 4 millimeter Allen that's in there.
Here's the easy way. I took a 5 millimeter Allen. This one I actually had cut down years back to get into tight spots. You can do that, but you could probably get away with it too without cutting one down. And then if you turn the bars all the way to one direction, you can sneak in on the back side here and get that in place carefully and snug it down. Right? And it doesn't have to be crazy tight, just enough so those ears won't move on you. And then you just move the handlebars in the other direction, and you could do the same thing on the other side. Okay? Write that down. Tell all your friends. All right, next thing to do is to aim the headlight. Now, you can do this the right way, or you can do it my way. I like doing things the right way, don't get me wrong. But I'm not sure if it's in this manual, but what you can do is you measure from the ground up, you mark a point on a wall a certain distance away, and then when you turn the headlight on, the center of the beam should be at that height. My garage is just short enough to do that. It would need to be a few feet deeper. So what I'm just going to do is, I'll point you in that direction against that wall of just stuff. I'm going to sit on the bike, sit it upright, turn on the headlight, and just kind of eyeball it for now. Let's do it. So, you can kind of see the center of the light right at the bottom of my sander there. I think I'm I think I'm okay with that, actually. That's right about where I want it, I think. And what I'm going to do now is I'll snug it down to that height, and then in the evening, when I take it out for a ride, I can bring my 12 millimeter wrench with me and adjust it as necessary. So let's turn the lights back on. Turn the headlight back off. Bring you back over here. Are you still with me? Thanks for hanging in there with me. And then we take my handy dandy 12 millimeter wrench, and it's just gonna snug that down without letting the headlight move in either direction. Now, if I was smart, before I took it off, I would have marked exactly where it was, but this will do for now. And then, like I said, when I go for a ride in the evening, I can readjust it on the fly, because it is just those the two bolts on either side of the headlight. Okay, final step, kids, is to adjust and tighten the gaiters. Let's do that and let's be done, because this is taking forever. Don't you agree? All right, last step. So first thing I want to do is just check under here. Since we pumped the forks, just make sure I don't see any oil. I do want to wipe that down just a smidge. Get any residual non-Scottish crap out of there. Okay, now I'm gonna turn these in the front here. There's the RE Royal Enfield emblem. I want those facing forwards, and then the bottom of the gaiter clips into this little line here. There's a little lip on the inside of the gaiter, right? And then you can pivot it as you find you want. Now they tell you to mount it all the way up there, right? That might look good on a scrambler. I'm gonna do this. I just like the juxtaposition of the chrome, black chrome, right? You could even do that if you like, but for now, I'll go right about there because I don't think my forks are gonna bottom out that much anyway. I just do want a little bit of the chrome, but again, they recommend all the way up, okay? I don't wanna do that. I'm gonna do that. Mainly for looks, just my tastes. So now there's this clamp at the top, and they supply you with an Allen bolt, a teeny tiny one. It's a 3mm, and it's teeny tiny nut. That's a 7mm. If you happen to have a ignition setup wrenches, you should find that in there. And let's just start tightening that up. Make sure everything's straight, right where I want it, right where I want it. Now you don't have to kill this, but you do want it to stay put as well. And I don't think leaving this gap, I don't think my forks are going to bottom out that far, ever. Alright, my battery's running out. Hopefully I can get this side done. Let me get my head in there real quick. Sorry. Alright. And then finish that up. There you have it. Now I'm going to measure that gap and do the same thing on the other side. I'll bring you back when I'm done. And there you have it. Fork gaiters. I ended up using the width of the ruler as my gauge. It was easier to do. I may end up having to move those up or down. If I can move them a little further down, I may. And here are the emblems I was mentioning. All right. So I know that all took a while, but I wanted to be thorough, show you everything I could. The only thing left to do now is ride it. I'm gonna do that, and I'd like to see if it still pulls to the right or not, and see how it handles with the 15 weight oil in there. I have yet to screw down the preload adjusters because I just want to see how the heavier oil does. So let me do all that. I'll come back, let you know what I think, and we'll talk in a bit. Well, dear friends, just came back from my ride. I did about, I don't know, 30 miles around, a lot of twisties and bumpies and what have yous. And the bike was freaking awesome. The 15 weight oil really just stiffened up the front end just where I like it to be. I get plenty of road response without it being too harsh, and it's not soft at all. I didn't have to at all adjust the preload, so that's fully out. But that's okay, I may change that at some point, and at the very least they look snazzy. And my fork gaiters gaitered quite well. I don't see or feel any oil leakage. They didn't move, which means I didn't bottom them out and have them hence push up. And guess what? My motorcycle pulling to the right is no longer a thing. So adjusting the height of the forks, so this one was lower, the right side, and it was pulling to the right. Now it tracks straight. If I'm riding and I take my hands off of the handlebars, the bike goes straight down the road. So Royal Enfield, keep an eye on that stuff. I'd like to thank you all for sticking around all this time. This was a longer video, but I hope you found it helpful and got some info that will help you do a similar job, or at least lead you in the right direction. On that note, thank you. Please subscribe, and if I understand correctly, you have to like my videos as well, and that will get them posted more. Okay, thank you. Thanks for hanging out. It was great to have company. Take care, folks. Bye-bye.